So, I want to start off by apologizing. My first slide is not about the dangers of cybersecurity or what's happening or how many attacks we had. We're all cyber professionals. We know the importance of cybersecurity. That's why we're here. I want to start off by talking about digital and what that means to cyber. And let's talk about the evolution of cybersecurity and how and where we are now. So, when we started in our cyber professions, we were looked at as inhibitors. As an example, you as a cyber professional would show up to somebody's desk, and they'd be like, oh my God, you're gonna slow down the process. Really? You mean I have to check my code before I put it in, live, into production? That's ridiculous. I've been writing code for years. Anybody familiar with that? Yeah. Then we slowly evolved. So people started understanding that there's something called information, right? And that information has value. So when they thought about that, then people started using it, and that people could use that for nefarious reasons. So then regulation came in. So we became a necessary evil. So you needed to become compliant. The auditor would show up once a year. Let me tick the box. Do you do this? Yes, yes, yes. Not that we just tick the box. Some of us actually go through the exercise. But they'd say, hey, thank you very much. You are now ISO 27001 compliant, NIST, whatever it is, right? And they'd come visit you next year. But now we are looked at as an enabler. So I'm going to ask a question. How many of you currently use your phone, your smartphone, to pay? Can I see a show of hands? Excellent. So would you do that if you didn't think it was secure? We're all professionals here. We wouldn't. So what have we done? You have just two-factor authenticated. See the change? That's the change that I'm talking about. So now, let's look at some of the trends. So we, as DXC, we've talked to many clients, we do our research, and these are some of the top trends that we've seen. You know, some of them are here, some of them may change, some of them be more relevant, less relevant, but they're gonna evolve. Now, why are these important? Before we get into why these are important, let's talk about business. So, we need to understand the drivers of business. So in business, there are two drivers at a very high level. You're either looking to increase revenue or decrease cost. Now let's look at government. In government, what are you measuring? You're measuring GDP, right? Or we call it engagement, health of a nation, citizens. Those are the two measurements. So when we look at those, now as cyber professionals, we look at these trends. We need to look at them through the eyes of those two variables, whether it be government or business. So I'm going to deep dive into some of these to further explain what I mean by that. Not all of them, I'm going to address maybe four or five. The first one is near and dear to all our hearts. Basic hygiene. So, it seems very simple at the top layer, but when it comes to implementing it, it is very difficult. Probably one of the most difficult things to do. And when you go ask business, hey, can I please have some money to do this? Let's example patching. Can I buy a tool? The response, I don't want to say is always no, but not very well received because it's looked at as a sunk cost. Now, how do we change that conversation internally to enable us to get what we need? I'm going to take passwords as a use case. Now, in the opening keynote, somebody said, the password is dead. I agree with that. We are competing with a smartphone. Yet, every 3 months, you get a nice reminder saying, hey, by the way, can you please update this password? Okay, that's great. And if you're using more than one system, you have to do it in multiple systems. And maybe some users, and I'm not saying we do it, may decide to write that down somewhere. And if you're a super user, God help us all. I don't need to tell you about the rest. So how do we approach this conversation differently? The way we approach it differently is we say, I am looking to enhance the user experience and improve efficiency of our employees by enabling them to log in once into multiple systems. Efficiency drives revenue, decreases cost, right? This is a business conversation. Then you say, hey, you know that there's all this cost, people are calling, here's how many people called the help desk, asking for me to reset the password, here's how many people I sent in, blah, blah, blah. So if I get this investment, it'll also help with that cost. Then we move to the second piece. Now we start talking about cyber, which says, by the way, anybody can take anyone's password, and I don't know if they're the right people doing that, but if I use something that's a little bit more safe, like facial recognition or thumbprint, whatever you want to use, or two-factor authentication, then I know who's logging in, what data they're accessing, and then we can prevent all the issues from happening. Mr. Business Owner, it is not a question of if, it is a question of when. So, you're either going to incur this cost now or double the cost should something happen, because you are going to have to pay for the remediation and then give me what I need to enable the business and enhance user experience. So let's say now we have dealt with basic hygiene. What do we need to look at next? We need to look at monitoring, making sure that the environment is safe. So SOC. Now, we all know that SOC has evolved from just monitoring to now being able to respond and remediate. But we've all had the discussion which says, hey, am I going to insource? Am I going to give it to somebody? I've given you all this money. It's sunk. Right, I don't see the ROI, and you go to him and say, hey boss, now there's this thing called AI, and you know, we're doing some analytics around this, I need more money to be relevant, and he tells you, sorry. But you know, I have 100 use cases and I've stopped a DDoS attack. That means nothing to business. Here's how there are two use cases that can show what this does. I'm going to use an airport as one example. So, you land in an airport, come, use your password, put a thumbprint, facial recognition, you walk in, it takes you 5 minutes. What a great experience. Now, what's happened in the background there, right? This all is fed into a machine, right? We can call it a SOC, we can call it whatever you want to call it. And they check, because there's different inputs coming in, and they say, oh, this person, check, this person, questionable, please, you may need to have a conversation, somebody shows up, has a conversation with you. Now, me as somebody who's landed, I feel comfortable, because I know this is happening in the background, and I still have a very pleasant experience. Now, you take that and you compare it to an airport that you land in, and it takes you an hour and a half to get through customs. What happens then? I will guarantee you that you will only visit that place if you have to. But where would you go? You would go to the place that took you 10 minutes to get through customs. What does that mean for that place? The airport, you're spending money there, so you're helping. National carriers, better. Maybe tourism, so you increase GDP. So you see, this is an actual use case in which you've helped increase revenue. Now I'm going to take another use case, which is an ATM. So some banks now are thinking about putting facial recognition in their ATM machines. So how do we take out bank money right now from banks? We put in your card, put in your code, take out money. Now what's the problem there? The problem there is, if somebody copies your card and gets your code, guess what? Good luck getting your money back. You call them, you go back and forth, you have to prove, there's paperwork, all this cost is going into the system. Now imagine a situation where you go into a machine, put in your card, put in your code, sees your face, excellent. Here you go, here's your money. What does that do? That removes part of that cost from the system. Now, what's the second piece of that? Safety. So let's say, for an example, there's somebody behind you that is forcing you to pull that money out. Now, because of AI, okay, and using analytics, the machine is smart enough to say, hey, this person is not authorized. So I'm not going to give you money. It sees your face, it recognizes you, but it also recognizes the person standing behind you and says, I'm not going to give you money. So what does that create? That creates a safer environment around you. So how does that help the bank? You then go, you're a happy person, you're a happy customer, you go to all the people and say, hey, this is secure. Increase revenue. As we're talking about money, we need to talk about crypto. But before we get into crypto, we need to talk about the basics of it. So let me just address blockchain really quick. Just high level. Blockchain is an auditable ledger. Why is that important for us in cyber? It's important for us in cyber because of use cases. So, in a very high level, what we need to worry about is the code secure, and can somebody drop something in the middle of the chain? Now let's get into the meat and potatoes, which is the use case, cryptocurrency. I am not going to debate if cryptocurrency exists or doesn't exist. But what I say is that currency is known as something of value that you're willing to accept in exchange for goods and services. And since people have accepted crypto as a medium of exchange, that means it exists. So why is that important for us as cyber professionals? It's important to us as cyber professionals because this impacts the basic foundation of banking. Banking is based on underwriting. What is underwriting? It means that me as an individual, when I go to a bank and I put my money in there, if somebody steals my identity and I can prove that, they're supposed to pay me back. But what happens in crypto? If somebody steals your identity in crypto, nobody pays you back. So where's the value? The value is your identity. So now, as cyber professionals, we need to change the way we're looking at it. Not only do we need to protect the company, but we also need to protect the individuals. So, when you get asked as a cyber professional, because you will be asked as a cyber professional, should we as an organization accept cryptocurrency as a currency or not? Let's go back to the fundamentals. So increase revenue, decrease cost. Your answer should be yes or no. If your answer is yes, you should say yes because I'm trying to enable you to increase your revenue. So this is another revenue stream. So what we need to ensure is that our clients are secure. So we need funding for that. If you say no, you need to say because the risk is too high, we might have to underwrite And so therefore, risk versus reward, cost might be high. So the answer to that is no. Now, as we're talking about protecting people, I want to talk about cyber warfare. I think it's very important. Recently, there's been a change in warfare. Previously, you need to attack multiple locations to impact multiple things. But now, you can attack one thing and impact multiple locations and multiple people. So think about that for a second. What does that do? That now means that if I am in an industry that basically is looking to do harm, this is where I'm going to put my investment. That's where I can get the maximum damage. So if we look at a business, what are you worried about? You're worried about people stealing your IP, right? Or you're worried about, you know, your competitors ruining your reputation, so a loss in revenue. But that's not what I want to focus on. What I want to focus on are citizens and protecting them. So I want to talk about Maslow's hierarchy of needs. In the second rule, it's security. And cybersecurity is now part of security. And why is it important for people to feel secure? It's important for people to feel secure because they need to get to the third level, which is basically feel empowered and feel that they a sense of belonging to an environment. So now, I want to bring this to a live use case and just touch on it very lightly. What happened last week in Singapore was some people decided to take information in the healthcare. So what does that do? We as citizens now say, yeah, I'm not going to give you my data. But look at the cost of that. Some of that data, if used correctly, can start predicting for citizens, okay, if there are diseases, or if, you know, most of the, if we're seeing an epidemic in a certain place, or let's say we say, hey, there's high cholesterol as citizens. So as an organization, as a government, we can start addressing these things very early on and preventing them. But if we don't give the data, then we don't enable that. So I would ask you to continue trusting. I'm going to leave you with some final thoughts now. So if you're a cyber professional in business, our role is to make sure that the core is secure, to understand the business drivers, and to enable them. If you're a cyber professional in the government sector, our goal is to ensure that our citizens and guests feel secure in order to encourage a better society. I want to thank you all for your time, and welcome to the era of digital cyber. Thank you.